Hare Krishna, dear devotees, and welcome to today's session. How are you doing? I pray that all is well with you and your families at this time. So today we've reached the final day of this Kartik month special. Although tomorrow is Purnima, tomorrow is the last day of Kartik, but we're ending today because it's 30 days that we've covered so far. So we're continuing with the summary of this 10th chapter, reading Prabhupada's summary, and today we're trying to cover the last part describing these two boys, Nalakuvera and Manigriva, as the trees came down. And we're exploring also the practical aspects of application to our everyday life from this beautiful pastime of Krishna and these two trees. So let's catch the summary from this point. Therefore, the punishment given by Vaishnavas is not at all punishment. Rather, it is another kind of mercy. So when we see devotees, especially our seniors and well-wishers, they're only acting that way because of love, because of care. And they want us to learn and to become proper, because every part of Krishna consciousness is learning. We are conditioned. So being conditioned means we have to relearn everything. Although by nature, we are fully Krishna conscious by the nature of the soul. We are servants of Krishna. But in a conditioned state, we have to relearn how to do all these things. So sometimes we get a bit stubborn. And in that mood then, when our well-wishers are trying to guide us and trying to help us, we misunderstand. And sometimes that can be detrimental. Sometimes due to the false ego, we were discussing this yesterday. Ahamkar vimudatma, Prabhupada was saying yesterday. Due to that false ego, we then move away from devotees, we then criticize Vaishnavas, and all these negative things start coming forth and gradually moves us back into the material realm. So when a Vaishnav helps us by his mercy, two times of mercy, Vaishnav has two types of nature. One is thunderbolt and the other is rose. So we see that Prabhupada had both these. Of course, we can't compare ourselves, but we're just giving the example of a Vaishnav's character and nature so that we can understand when they're trying to help us. Because love comes in different forms. We only like the soft love, the one that, oh, you're so nice, you're so good, you're so great, Prabhu. Wow, you're so good, Prabhu. Yeah, all those ones we like. But Bhaktisiddhanta would say that one story where that one guy would come every day to his Pandal program and criticize. And one day he didn't come at all. And then the devotees were so happy, oh, Prabhupada, just see, Bhaktisiddhanta Prabhupada, just see, this guy hasn't come anymore. And Bhaktisiddhanta started to cry. And he said, now who will correct me? Who will be bold enough to correct me? And who will help me on my journey? So it's a covered type of love. They're only doing it not out of malice, not out of hate, not out of envy, especially your well-wishers, your shiksha gurus. When they are correcting you and trying to help us understand, it's always done with a deep sense of love. It's because they've built that relationship of trust with you. That is why they're able to tell you these things, which are so difficult to accept for the false ego. But the love is so deep, the connection and relationship is so deep that they're willing to risk it just to help you progress. So it's done out of love. So it goes on to say, by the curse of the Deva Rishi, Nalakuvera and Manigriva became twin Arjun trees and remained in the courtyard of Mother Yashoda and Nanda Maharaj, waiting for the opportunity to see Krishna directly. So you can see, we were giving the topography of Gokul. So how big was the courtyard? If this was the courtyard and Utkal Bandhan is the lower part of Gokul, so how big was this courtyard? It was huge. Hmm? So they were just waiting because they've been cursed. And one day Krishna will come close. One day Krishna will probably touch us. One day Krishna will probably allow us to offer him some shade. As a tree, what do? You completely naked and you completely rooted. You can't move, you can't do anything. You're completely dependent on nature to grow you and do all the things that trees need. So they were praying that maybe one day Krishna will come by. So this hankering for Krishna is the purification. So first the curse of Narada, and then they understood that their original positions, actually they have very exalted positions in the spiritual world. They may have been condemned to become trees, and before that Nalakuvera and Manigriva in the heavenly planets, but their spiritual sthai bhav, their spiritual position in the spiritual world is very exalted. It's described in Gopal Champu, in the beginning of Gopal Champu, that these two personalities, Nalakuvera and Manigriva, they are Snigdha Kanta and Madhu Kanta. Kanta means throat, or voice, or the sweetness from the voice. So Snigdha Kanta, Snigdha and Madhu means like deep affection and honey-throated. So what is their service? In the eternal pastimes of Radha and Krishna, every day as Krishna and Balaram and all the coward boys come back and have their supper and everything, after that in this courtyard of Nanda Baba, all the Brajbasis come to see what did they do today. So these two are like poets and they tell what are the pastimes of Krishna today. So everybody comes to hear, this is what Krishna did today, this is what Balaram did today, this is what they did. Snigdha Kanta and Madhu Kanta. And we also hear that when these trees fell down, you know, the sadhus, they wear wooden shoes. You know that pastime where Krishna carried Nanda Baba's shoes on his head and he would walk and go and put Nanda Baba's shoes on. This is a deep respect he had for his pure devotee in paternal love, Krishna's father, Nanda Baba. So that wooden shoes is made out of wood. And where did that wood come from? So it's described that that wood that made that wooden shoes that Nanda Baba wears comes from the trees of these Arjun trees. It comes from these Arjun trees that were one time Nalakuvera and Manigriva. So very beautiful. You can see how they're serving and how they, by the curse of Narada, look at their great fortune. They became Snigdha Kanta and Madhu Kanta back in the spiritual world. And they constantly narrating Krishna's pastimes. So it goes on to say, Lord Krishna, by the desire of his devotee, uprooted these Yamal Arjun trees. And when Nalakuvera and Manigriva were thus delivered by Krishna, after 100 years of the Devas, their old consciousness revived. So we can see this, that it was by Narad's desire that Krishna acted. It's because the devotee had mercy on us. I was telling you my personal story of Sadbhuj Prabhu, who came visiting home when I wasn't even a devotee at that time. So we never know how the devotees bless us. So this was a curse, but it ended up being the biggest blessing. And their original consciousness as Snigdha Kanta and Madhu Kanta became revived. And they reinstated themselves as the eternal servants of Krishna. So it goes on to say, and they offered Krishna prayers suitable to be offered by demigods. So we know how Krishna reacts to prayers, especially in Vrindavan. He doesn't like it there. You know, when Brahma came and offered his prayers, he just said, oh, when this four-headed guy is going to finish? So he's not into that mood, but he's accepting the bhava. He's accepting the sentiment of the devotee because it's genuine. They don't know what else to do because there's no rasa. There is no relationship with Krishna in that conditioned state. So they don't know how to react. They don't know how to relate and how to act with Krishna. So therefore, best thing to do, offer prayers. We see that with Dhruva Maharaj also. Dhruva Maharaj in the fourth canto, he also, when he was doing all this heavy, heavy tapasya, and finally when he saw the Lord, he became stunned. And Lord had to touch him with a conch shell on his head, and then all these beautiful prayers started coming out. So the devotee, Vandanam, is very natural to glorify the Lord. But what glorification will be fit for Krishna when he's unlimited? You're going to say, you are like the cloud, you are like this, like that. Those are all material things. It's an embarrassment. And that's why at the end of the day, it becomes an offense to him. You're comparing me to a cloud? You're comparing me to a black cloud, rain cloud? That's the best you can do? So we have to, in the dualistic world, in the conditioned world, the dualistic world, we only understand and relate to comparison. Everything is compared, light and dark, then we can see, sound and silence, then we can hear. So everything functions with comparison and duality. But for the Lord, how do you compare Him to anything? You can't. But you want to glorify. So the only thing Krishna can accept is your sentiment. The only thing He's really accepting is our sentiment. What can you offer Krishna? Your bhoga that you're offering, is it so pure in love that He's accepting? He doesn't need that earthly cauliflower, earthly paneer, earthly green beans. So what can He accept? That sentiment is not material. That sentiment is not a material, it's devotion. So that's the only thing Krishna can accept. And that's the only thing we can actually offer Him. So if we work on developing our devotion deeper, more feeling, to offer with feeling. Prabhupada said that in that Los Angeles installation of Dwarkadish. He said, you offer with feeling, just like Sanatan Goswami. And Krishna, you go to Krishna and say, my Lord, I brought this for you. Please accept it. It's not that Sanatan Goswami was offering batti, gulgula, but roasted in fire directly. No salt also he was giving, no salt. But Gopal was eating. Gopal was eating that. Why? Because the sentiment was so deep. So there's nothing we can actually offer Krishna, because everything we offer is material. But our sentiment, our feelings, our devotion is not. So the deeper we can offer that part of it, the more we can attract Krishna. So he goes on to say, having thus gotten the opportunity to see Krishna face to face, they understood how merciful Narada Muni was, and therefore they expressed their indebtedness to him and thanked him. So they finally realized, wow, we got Krishna just because of Narada. And they became so grateful to him. So, so grateful. How do you repay the spiritual master for giving us this insight, for breaking our illusion? Nobody else is doing it. Even religion of today is not doing it. They're all saying go to heaven. They're all saying go to heaven. So if you go to heaven, and we were discussing this, that heaven was created in 7 days. The earth and the heavens was created. So you're going to a place that's created, means the Lord is not there. Because where was He standing when that place was created? That is Goloka. That is where you want to go. That He says in the 15th chapter. Na tat bhasate suryo na sashanko na pavaka yat kattvam na nivartante tat dhamam paramam mama. You want to go to that dham which is paramam, and it's mama, it's mine. It's supreme place. Come to that abode. Tyakva puna janma neti ma meti so Arjuna. You come to me Arjuna, come to my abode. So that's the place we want to go. We don't want to go to heaven. God is not in heaven. That is where we burning out our good karma. That's all we're doing there. And then come back. Puna janma. A Brahma Bhuvana Loka Puna Varjino Arjuna Mamo Petyat Kunteya Puna Janma Navidyate. So we have to, this from Brahma Loka right down is places of repeated birth and death. So where is Brahma Loka? Is there by heaven? It's heavenly, Satya Loka. So you want to go there, what will be your future? What will be your fortune? You'll Nothing. You're just burning out good karma. That's all. So be careful of also accumulating good karma, doing too much of pious things, because piety awards you good karma. So how should we act now? We shouldn't do bad. We shouldn't do good also. I heard everybody say don't do bad. You saying don't do good also? I'm saying yes. Fifth chapter Bhagavad Gita, Krishna is saying three kinds of karma. Vikarma, bad karma. Karma, good karma. And akarma, devotional service. So act, but act in devotional service. Don't do good karma, don't do bad karma. Do devotional service. That is the only thing that can free you. There is no karma involved in that. Therefore, after circumambulating the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna, they departed for their respective abodes. So we see Brahma did the same thing. Brahma also circumambulated. And these demigods also, so it's a feature of the demigods that they walk around three times. That's why all Vaishnav temples has the opportunity to walk around the altar. You see our beautiful Radharadhanath temple, we have that opportunity to walk around the altar three times. So that is what circumambulating the Lord, because by doing that you're covering everything in existence. That's why you'll see that they turn around. Why do they do that? Because God is omnipresent. So they're offering pranams in all directions. Even Arjuna in 11th chapter Gita, the universal form, he also did that. He said, I don't know which side to offer pranams. You're all over the place. Where do I offer to you? Yeah. So it becomes confusing. So the devotee just turns around and offer. But Vaishnavas, we walk around Krishna. So notice, he did the same thing like Brahma. They repeat, they turned around and got their celestial form. But what is the defect of this? Because there's no sambandha with Krishna, they went back to their material experience. Just like that story. And how unfortunate is that? You're right there with Krishna, he liberated you, and you go back to your material experience. How unfortunate is that? Why? Because they have no sambandha jnana. They have no relationship with Krishna. They wasn't taught in one of the five rasas. So they don't know how to relate. Then you go back. Therefore, we see that famous story of the old lady carrying the sticks, bundle of sticks on the head. And as she's walking, that fell down. And she said, oh Krishna! And the whole bundle of sticks fell. So she cried with such devotion that Krishna came there. Oh, what happened? What happened? Oh, my bundle of, I'm old and this bundle of sticks fell. Can you put it back on my head? This is what these devotees did. They, instead of saying, you Krishna, right here, take me back to Godhead. They said, put the bundle of sticks back on my head. So only a guru can teach you. That's why without guru, you won't know what to do. You'll become totally bewildered and Maya will bring you so close and take you back. You'll become like the tide in the beach. The tide in the ocean, it comes right up to the beach and it goes back. It does, it's got no relationship with the land. It just comes up to the beach and goes back. This is why Guru is so important, because Guru is teaching us sambandha jnana. Guru is teaching us, this is your relationship with Krishna. This is what you should do. This is how you should act. This is how to attract Krishna. Guru is giving devotional service. That is why it's so vital to be initiated. Otherwise you won't know. You'll go right up to Krishna, turn and come back. And how misfortunate. Look at what these guys did. Look at what these two devatas did. They came all the way. They 100 years is standing in the courtyard of Vrindavan. All that mercy, but no guru, come back. Because you don't, nobody to teach you how to relate with Krishna. You just walk around three times and go back home, back down to the material world. You're already in Godhead, but you go back down. How misfortunate is that? Therefore, it's so rare to find a spiritual master. Guru Krishna Prasada Pai Bhakti Lata Beej. To get that Bhakti Lata Beej, the seed of devotional service in the heart is so rare, and the guru is the one that plants that. So how special is the spiritual master? Very, very special. So we've come to the end of the Damodar Leela. But it's also, we call, that is the Yasoda pastime. It's also called Radha Damodar. We know this in Krishna Karanamrita, Bilva Mangala Thakur. Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami wrote a commentary on this. And in that commentary, he relates the story of Radha Damodar. That Purnamasi, it was in the Kartik month and she had a festival. So because it's probably the Diwali or so many festivals in Kartik. So Krishna had went for that festival and he came and met Radharani late. And she was so upset that she took out her waistband or a sash and she tied Krishna up with that. And Krishna was so pleased with that effort of Radharani that he benedicted that I'll also be known as Radha Damodar, not only Yashoda Damodar, because Radharani had tied him up. We see also at Govardhan, on the western side of Govardhan, there's a place called Gulal Kund. Gulal Kund. And in there, the marriage pastime once took place of Radha and Krishna. It also took place in Bandiravan, but this one was at Govardhan. And all the gopis and the sakis were there, and Radha and Krishna were sitting on a bench there. And from the back, some naughty, you know, little girls, how naughty they can be. So they, from the back, one of the sakis, they went behind and they tied Radharani's sari with Krishna's dhoti. And they tied and they're sitting. So everybody saw it. All the sakis, all the gopis saw it. But Radha and Krishna didn't know. And you know, little girls, as they start giggling, you know. So these little girls, they started to giggle. And Radha and Krishna figured out something is wrong. And when they got up, they looked and they said, oh, there's a knot here. That means they're married. So they've been tied together and everybody was so happy to see Radha and Krishna together in this way. So this also took place in Gulal Kund in Govardhan. And of course the Bandiravan where Radha and Krishna were actually married by Lord Brahma, that took place there at Bandiravan under that big Vats tree, the banyan tree there. Bandiravan is the banyan tree, beautiful area of Braj. So devotees, this is the end of our Kartik month special. Thank you for your association. Thank you for sharing 30 days of your time with me. And thank you for all the association. And I hope you've benefited from it as much as I did sharing these with you. And we look forward to another session very soon. So please enjoy your Kartik. Tomorrow is the last day. Tomorrow is Purnima. For those who are doing Bhishma Panchak, you'll end at midday tomorrow. And you can still offer the lamp tomorrow evening and that will be the end of Kartik 2020. So, thank you so much. I really appreciated your association. Vancha kalpaturubhyascha kripa sindubhyevacha patitanam pavanebhyo vaishnavebhyo namo namaha. Ananta koti vaishnava vrinda ki jai. Hare Krishna.